system. Media. You know what field is?
Field of numbers.
So it's actually, it's also a space. We call it measurable space. Another name for it. So that way it has all the properties of field, because what happens is that mu is a measure, operator or subspace of X to produce numbers, and these numbers are what constitute a field. You know, fields just like a vector field, vector space. You have the vector with the scalar. You have non spaces, X. So in that case, we are going to view measure as an operator now. Mu can be view mu in this case. Can be viewed as an operator on X. Okay, of course, when I say on X, I mean on subspace of X, including X itself. So mu operates on X, so mu operates on Xi contained in X to produce measure. So, and like we said, we saw in the last lecture, these are actually values. Exactly. So they are actually, we expect this to be a number, an element of R, the real line. That is one property of measure that is very interesting, that it constitutes a space just like we have. Used to have this, you call it topological specificity.
Yes, sir.
And you have another one, you say matrix space with D, and so on and so forth. So you also have like this. So this measure in that case will produce a structure now. That's why it gives you out a structure. And we have seen some of the Borel algebra, sigma algebra, algebra of sets, and so on. So they are mathematical structures. So they emanate from this space. You are going to have a number of mathematical structures emanating from this space. Actually, this space. So another definition is that, you know, when we took X, we also took sigma, and we said what? Sigma is what? We say set of Si, or let me call them Xi now, such that each Xi is contained in what? In X. That means subspace of X. Then in that case, Sigma gave us collection then of subspace of X. So it means therefore we can have something like this. Another definition, we can start with X and an empty set, then sigma
collection associated with that, and then apply major on this collection. And what we use that, we say we have major sigma.
Okay, okay. Now, I mean, you see, in this one we saw a lot of examples, didn't we, really? So we can have another one. A typical one is consider R, so then 9. So this is example. And consider intervals in R. Consider Now, suppose you now say apply then your function, because ultimately, like it has been shown here, mu is looking like a function acting on x or on sigma, and giving back major of acting on xi, of course, and giving rise to a mu of. So it's like a function now. It takes a subset of sigma xi and it measures it. That's why you say it is an operation. Now, supposing you now define, so you have to define mu. If you define mu, define major mu. To be the counting major. Subsets. That is, i.e., mu counts number of points in each. Then, is it sigma finite? Is it finite? Number of points. Let's say, for example, from 1 to 2. Number of points. Actually, it's not finite. There are countable many of them, but it's sigma finite. This is sigma finite number. It will give you, because there are countable many of them in R, since they are countable. Many such. So they are countable. That means they give you sigma algebra, but in themselves they are not finite. They are finite because
Also, they are finite because in the equilibrium plane, they are not finite, but they are countable. So, but each one is finite because the nature of AI, BI, in the equilibrium plane is defined to be DI minus what? In terms of definition measure, which is the interval. But in terms of counting the number of points, that's where the problem is. Because it will take infinitely many steps to count all the points between 1 and 2, for example. All the points. Remember, all AIs in R, we are talking about R.
It's a real number,
natural number. Irrational numbers, rational numbers, or whatever. Like so many of them. But if you go by the definition of measure, that's the difference between two circles. So it will give you just number. But if you are to count the number of elements, then it's not measurable. So that's why we say it's not finite. But is sigma finite? Sigma finite means you can count the number of intervals. Okay. So now, but in that case, now we're talking about intervals now. I think we have a good foundation to talk about Lebesgue, because what Lebesgue is doing is to study equations in terms of standardizing it. These are integral equations of x. Now a graph of f of x like this, maybe f of x equals x squared, whatever. Now, if you want to find the area of this f of x, what happens? You take what? The integral f of x, that's a definite integral. So this is a, this is b, we say from a to b, that's it. What Lebesgue is doing is that he's dividing this into rectangles so that now the integral f d mu over E now, then he takes the whole of this as a set E, isn't it? Because it's a subset of R. Over E, the mu, will be alpha I mu of E I, okay? Where E I is are these ones. Maybe this is E1, E2, E3 and so on, isn't it? And the whole of this is E. So it subdivides, it takes the area of the subinterval and then adds them off together with respect to some constant. Then you will be able to. You are adding constant because what this is doing is like approximation. We are doing approximation here. Because the rectangles are actually only, this rectangle will stop here. So you have this area unaccounted for. This rectangle, for example, maybe will stop here. Because this rectangle will stop here. This one is unaccounted for. And so on and so forth. So you have them like that. So this is what technically Lebesgue is saying about integration. You can find the area between this graph by taking the sum of the areas of the individual rectangles. So what it's just like what we have been doing. We have a set X, this is our X now. Then this is our XI. X1, X2, subset. So you have a set X,
or E, set of EIs such that each EI is contained in E. So you now collect them, E1, E2, E2, and so on. So what the bat is saying, if you won't find the area of this, you won't integrate this.
Integrate this. This is the integral of this, the same as the integral of this. And this, when you do the integral on the areas of the individual terms. So he's doing this, and we are using the indicator function. And there is one concept which is also part of the notations you should do about your bats. Part of the notation we need to do is to know about notation. One, indicator function. I assume we met indicator function in the last. Why is the Laval's new indicator function? We defined it to be. This actually distinguishes between those points within the set and those points outside the set. Yes. So, for example, because we define this one, for example, if you have a set A, or you take one of this, E1, you know E1 is contained in E, or you define this as E1. Then you define indicator of E1 to be that marking which takes elements of X, the point, to be equal to 1 if this X belongs to your E1, and to be 0 if this X does not. Or maybe it wants to be. Yes, so that means when you are coming to evaluate E1, all those points outside E1 will not matter. So that's why the indicator function is very important. And there is a second one, which you call simple function. Says that such indicator functions can be enumerated using summation of EI alpha I number. You put alpha I because of a constant, this constant of integration, isn't it? Because you always have a constant of integration attached to any integral. So this will now combine with indicator function to give you a sense of integration in Laplace, which is, for example, f dx over e to be equal to, till you get this. Will be we define
Tigran Abdi News to be equal to sum alpha I of I from 1 to N.
And this was the definition we had before about this.
And it's what we are going to use to do some examples. We have the real value numbers. If L and G are integrable functions, and alpha, beta are real numbers, okay, then integral alpha f plus beta g or g mu equal to, this is number one, this is equal to alpha and mu integral g. That's number one. Number two. Number two says f integrable and negative almost everywhere. F integrable and negative almost everywhere implies integral f d nu is bigger than zero. And number three, saying that if f is bigger than g almost everywhere, then integral f d nu will be bigger than integral of g.
So we shall try to prove this.
This theorem. Observe that alpha f plus beta g, the mu is alpha, this all follows alpha f plus beta g all the mu will be equal to alpha l the mu plus beta g. The mu from what? Additivity property. Additivity of beta. The number of measures are additive, isn't it? Yes. And that's how we use sum. We say from I from 1 to N. So, but this is equal to alpha integral f d nu plus beta integral g d nu, which you require. So this is as a question. So we use one good property, additivity property of measure. Every measure is additive. Second, number two. Now, f integrable and non-negative, f is bigger than zero. That's what we need. Okay, integral, so f is non-negative, almost everywhere. It implies that now if you put f, d mu, you will get something bigger than zero.
relative. Since what? Since major of anything, maybe F or E, whatever, X is equal to zero, only if what? X is zero, isn't it? So the least it can be is zero. You cannot, you don't have negative measure. And by definition of measure, you know that definition of measure, measure of, if you have interval, we say what? If you have interval, if S is an interval, we say it's absolute value. And absolute value is always positive, which is at least zero. So these two are enough to show you that this is our holds number two. Now number three. Number three also holds. Says F is bigger than G, almost L. So what it means is what? You take the difference F minus G. This difference will be what? At least bigger than G. Isn't it? So if you take the integral f minus g du to be bigger than 0, this implies what? Integral of f du by additivity minus integral g du will get something bigger than 0, isn't it? And if you the two quantities give you something bigger than zero, what does that mean? It means what? It means integral f du. In fact, I can even use, if you like, you can say f du is actually bigger than equal to g. Because I started with equality. So if it is strictly greater, then this will be strictly greater. This will be strictly greater. Strictly greater. You can be this way. And the third one is good. Then theorem 2. Which we see in the statement of theorem 2. If f is integral function, alpha and beta are their numbers, and e is measurable set such that when f and e, f of x is between alpha and beta, then s alpha measure of e is less than or equal to less than. So it's just the inequality. This theorem is question about the F is an integral function. This will be theorem 2. F is integrable function. Alpha and beta are real numbers. Alpha and beta are real. Okay, they are real numbers. And the E is measurable set. And the E is measurable. Measurable set. Okay. Such that for
any X in E, then this inequality alpha is less than equal to double S. Then what we say is that alpha major E will be less or equal to integral of the mu will be less than the beta major. So this is okay, proof. What this is saying is that you have a measurable space, measurable sex on E, and you have two numbers, real numbers alpha and beta, such that one is smaller, alpha is smaller than beta, and otherwise X takes values between alpha and beta. So you have a function here of that whose values lie between alpha and beta. Yes, then what it means is that now if you put alpha, then major the set E. Remember, X, you have a set now E, and you take it, an element X, so in this set, and then try to take the, and you know, and you also know that alpha is less than equal to f of x less than equal to b. Then when you now come and put the integral over e, or major of e, this is you have alpha on side. This will be less than the f of x here will be in the between. F of x, the mu, of course, mu e the mu, because this is also the mu. And this will be less equal to beta integral mu major of E over E, of course, the mu from 1. So I call this, this is from 1, from inequality, because it's already given. It's already here, isn't it? No, this is, sorry, this is 1. It's already here, it's alpha. So, this is what is given, this is what you have to find, isn't it? So you use what is given to find what you have. Maybe, let me restate it again. What is alpha? This is already given. So all you need to do is to take, so let me say, take major across 1, across the infinite. Then you apply the major now. On E. Course. Yeah, because your set is. So in that case, we now say now, therefore, major alpha major of E, because you are given measurable, you say A, E is measurable, will be less than equal to L. Integral now, because this is f, this is a function now, isn't it?
we take the integer
F,
the new,
and we have, so we are here now. We're going to recall you.
This is just beta, it's not a function.
Beta measure. Okay. Here we say integrate over it because I measure it. So here I will also measure it. But because it's function, it will be integral. And this is 2. This already, this is the required inequality. Because not, now if you take, even if you take the integral, not that, even if you take the integral across, you say integral of alpha over E, d mu, this integral of alpha d mu, will just leave at alpha major, will just give you. This will give you alpha, because alpha is used. It will give you at alpha, the mu over what? E, isn't it? And this is simply alpha measure. So that's what you have here. Likewise, if you take the integral of the beta here, you say integral beta, d mu, sorry, over e, of course, because e is your measurable set. It will just be the same as beta will be outside. Integral mu, d mu of e, that is measure of e. So this is simply beta measure, which you have here, isn't it? Yes, so this is how we establish this independent. And that completes the proof. That theorem, you go to theorem 3. Theorem 3. So let us see the statement of theorem 3. Okay. It says if an integrable function f is negative almost everywhere, then its indefinite integral is monotone. Okay. If an integrable function is negative almost everywhere, then its definite integral is monotone. That's the proof. How do you prove this until you get another marker? Now, proof is take two sets, E and F. So to that, E is continuing. And I think you can quickly apply the monotone property of measure, isn't it? So, but because we know if this happens, we know measure of E will be what? Measure of F.
because of monotonic monotone growth.
This we know from the definition.
That this marker is also changing markers.
Okay, no. Another one.
Okay.
Then it follows if you take now the definite integral over E, isn't it? Over E. Two functions, maybe whatever is function from L could be new. Okay. Well, this will be less than integral over F now. G, let me not say G. Or whatever G did. Where F, G are equal almost everywhere. Why is it so? Because of one, okay? Since in one, E is a subject of F, isn't it? So the measure of F over E will be bigger than the measure of E. And that's what we want to establish. That is the integral F d mu is bigger than the integral of the mu over E can be smaller than the integral of what? You want, you can put from that. Since the two are almost the same, almost equal, you can interchangeably use. And that's what you want to change. So that the integral is monotone. That is the definite integral over E and F. F, so it's monotone. Note, you can also show that not if on the other hand, F is smaller than E, then we can show that integral of F over F is smaller than integral. So now say this is monotone increasing, this is monotone decreasing. But they are all monotonic, that means another all of them are monotonic. That's theorem 3. And now theorem 4. So maybe you know, you also have proof in your lecture, not? Of course, there it is. A bit different from the ones that you did. But they are also correct. Theorem 4. The definite integral of an integral function is absolutely continuous. The definite
integral. Of an integrable function is absolutely continuous. This is similar to the continuity property we saw in the last lecture, where we said sets are continuous from below or continuous from above. We can describe them as B1 content, B2 content, and so on. Now we say this EN. Well, now we know, so continuity, maybe I may take you. The proof, if En is contained in En plus 1, what does that mean? It means this implies continuity, continuity from above, it continues from above. Also, we can have situations where we have En plus 1 is contained, and this will be continuity from. In other case, it is continuous. What we are saying is integral functions. So, suppose these are the functions now, F. Greater than value than f d here is continuous c. By definition, f d mu absolute value over e will be less than or equal to c. Because what we are doing is that this is what we want to achieve. But we start with we take L over E, absolute value. Mm-hmm. So the absolute value of a function. But we are taking integrable function, okay, absolute value of this. By definition, this is we can write this by the property of function. Because you don't write function as a robot, but you write the integral, because integral is actually the number. Is the literate integral is always a value. So instead of putting the absolute value on the function, you put the absolute value. So then now that means F, you evaluate F over E. E is your measurable set. And then whatever you get, because it's definite integral. You know, definite integral is the problem, either it can be negative, it can be positive. Because if you are lower limit, normally, you know, when you define literate integral from A to B, if this is minus, what is it? Isn't it a prime? But whatever it is, then you put the interval from what? From A to minus B. So you have, so you evaluate a number. You have a number here, maybe in terms of X. Then you evaluate from minus B to B. Then that means this will give you minus B minus B. And ultimately, what you are going to get will be negative.
So you can have negative results.
So what you do to avoid that is you now put absolute value after
the trigger.
So in that case, this is after. So this is after. So even if it's negative, it's now negative. So this is going to be C, the concept of integration, and the major of E. And that means this is continuous. What do I say? It's continuous because this is continuous. Because if EN is contained in EN plus 1, then the absolute value of this, our EN, will be less than or equal to absolute value of this, our what? EN plus 1, and so on and so forth. It's also continuous, actually. What we get will also satisfy the continuity property. That is theorem 4. Says if f is an integral function and e is a set of measure zeros, then if f is an integral function. This is theorem 5. Integral function. Okay. And what? And P is a set of major 0. Major 0. Then integral over EF mm-hmm. the new. So this looks like straightforward. Why is this straightforward? Because E is set of major zero. That means it has no elements inside. And you are integrating F over an empty set. By definition, integral over E f d nu will be some constant of integration first. Major of E. But we know E is of major zero. Major zero. I.e. major of E we know is zero, isn't it? Then integral f d mu over E will be C times zero, which is zero. So I.e. the integral f d mu over E is actually zero. And it's straightforward. Okay, good. Theorem 6, I think. This is the last one here.